When I was working as a microbiologist, a day in the lab would go like this. I would mix a powder called nutrient agar with water in a beaker and then chuck it into a fancy oven to make it sterile. I would then pour the warm liquid into little containers called Petri dishes, where the liquid would cool and solidify into jello. And once that was done, I would do it all over again. And again. And again. Like 100 times a day. That's what I spend most of my time doing. And that's because Petri dishes are amazing. They're easy to prepare, they stack nicely, and the jello inside them provides the perfect nutrient-filled habitat for well-studied bacteria like E. coli to grow on top of. Petri dishes are basically the perfect research tool. But as great as they are, they have a huge drawback. Only a tiny percentage of bacterial species will grow on the jello. The other 98% of them simply refuse to. Hi, I'm Lizah, and this is my MinuteEarth. E. coli are easy to please. I would know, I've grown literally billions of them. In the human gut, they live on warm, smooth surfaces with easy to access nutrients. In the lab, Petri dishes can mimic that lifestyle pretty well. But while it's easy to think of bacteria as all really similar, in reality, they are a super diverse group of organisms with incredibly different lifestyles. I mean, consider animals for a second. You wouldn't build an aquarium, throw a monkey in it, and be surprised that it isn't happy. An aquarium is just too different from a monkey's natural habitat. Similarly, most types of bacteria cannot grow on nutritional jello in a Petri dish because it's just too different from their natural environment. For example, these bacteria grow in marine sediment where the bottom layer has sulfur, but no oxygen, and the top layer has oxygen, but no sulfur. So its food is at the bottom and its air is at the top. These bacteria form a vertical conga line where the top one breathes and the bottom one eats. Then they exchange energy in the form of literal electricity. The flat, horizontal surface of Petri dish jello doesn't allow them to do the things they need to survive. Some bacteria, like Vibrio fischeri, are really good friends with other organisms. They grow in the light-producing organs of the bobtail squid. It's so cute! The luminescent bacteria help the squid camouflage itself. If you want to study these friendships in the lab, you'll have to actually build an aquarium full of squid to grow together with these bacteria. And some bacteria are parasites that will only grow within living animal cells. But not in a friendly way. This is the case for the bacteria that causes syphilis. Putting a bacteria on a plate of jello is like feeding them candy bars, which does work for some species, but other species, like syphilis, are pickier. They need a constant supply of fresh nutrients like you can only get inside a host cell. And some bacteria grow in environments that we can't replicate because we still don't know enough about them. All organisms need something from their environment, like how the bacteria that live in thermal vents need a ton of heat, while others need high amounts of salt, and still others need blood. These things aren't difficult to provide in Petri dishes, but the key is knowing what the little bugs need, which can create a catch-22 situation. We can't figure out what it is that the bacteria specifically needs to grow because we can't study it, because we simply don't know how to grow it. Because of all these difficulties, the vast majority of what we know about bacteria comes from the easy-to-please E. coli that thrive in Petri dishes, which have been a huge boon to microbial science. But at the same time, my mind boggles at the thought of all the species we don't know about simply because they don't grow on Petri dishes. But lab techniques evolve, and we are now learning more about the world of bacteria by bringing the lab outside, or by bringing some of the outside world inside. One day, Petri dishes might even become obsolete, but I will still love them. I mean, look at this jello. It's alive! We made this video in collaboration with the Center for Electromicrobiology at Aarhus University, who made it their mission to learn as much as they can about the cable bacteria we mentioned in this video. Although you can see them with the naked eye, cable bacteria were only discovered in 2012 in a town in Denmark when researchers plugged chemical sensors in the sea. Today, the Center for Electromicrobiology combines forces with geochemists, molecular biologists, physicists, and ecologists to find out all sorts of cool things about cable bacteria, like how they make their own electric wires from proteins that could one day replace the toxic wires in our smartphones, or that their presence in a rice plantation can reduce its methane emissions by more than 90%. In other words, there are a bunch of reasons to keep on digging in the mud,